share his Father's throne. Gather all the nations to him, every knee will bend, bow down. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. You are worthy, Father, Creator, you are worthy, Savior, Sustainer, you are worthy, worthy and wonderful.
Jesus. Died from COVID, and so I preached his funeral on the this past Wednesday. So every day that we get up and we don't have that disease, we're blessed of God. Amen. Because you just pass by it. They don't know how you get it or when you get it, but you can get it. Hopefully the shots will be out soon. I don't know how many plan to take it. I'm taking it. If it turns me to a donkey, I'll be a donkey. Be God's will. I don't really worry about the small things in life. So when I was in the Army for 10 and a half years, we often went through shot lines with the air guns they used to shoot you with. Take five shots on each side. You didn't know where you were taking monkey shots or what kind of shots it was. So I guess if I can survive that, I can survive this. If you would, please take your Bibles this morning and turn with me to a very familiar story, the Christmas story, Luke chapter 2, and we're going to read beginning with verse 7 and read down through verse 15. Luke chapter 2, reading verse 7 through verse 15. If you would, please stand now in reverence for the reading of God's Word. Let me ask you this morning, have you realized that the greatest thing that happened on that first Christmas wasn't just Jesus coming to earth, but it was how God had planned and arranged his coming. God left some things out at his birth that were very necessary so everyone in this room could be saved. And I'm going to tell you about those things this morning. Let's read beginning with verse 7. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and lay him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And holy, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. May we pray. Father our God, we thank you so much this morning for the privilege and the blessing of being here to experience the presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I know sometimes we come to church because it's the right thing to do. It's the expected thing of Christians. And we come because we want to support and be with our friends in fellowship. All of those reasons are good. But Lord, if we have entered into this place today expecting nothing, we'll leave this place experiencing nothing. But if we come here today expecting the Holy Spirit to speak a new word to our heart, to empower us and to infill us anew with His Spirit, we'll leave here rejoicing and leaping and saying, Oh, how wonderful it was to be in the house of the Lord. Today, Lord, bless those that are sick. Heal them, dear God, in accordance with thy will. Bless those who've lost loved ones. And I pray, Lord, that they'll not see the loss, but, Lord, they'll see the gain that one has received as they have looked Jesus face to face. Now, Lord, bless each one in this place. And if there's one lost today, my prayer is that they can't leave here without inviting Jesus into their heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please be seated. You know what breaks my heart today is still in this enlightened age in which we live, there's still people that do not understand how important that first Christmas was. Oh, we know that God sent His Son from on high to be born in the flesh of a man as a little child. We know that Mary was a virgin. She was given Jesus through the Holy Spirit. And yet, that's all that we seem to think of. But do you realize there's some things that happened on that first Christmas? Things that were actually missing that afforded you and you and you and myself to receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Had they been different, we would have been shut out. But because of the things that were missing, Jesus came in and allowed the lowliest of low to receive Him as their Lord and personal Savior. I'll never forget my best friend. I was only 8 years old, and we lived a good distance from each other because his daddy was the mayor of the town. We lived on a cotton farm. We were sharecroppers. But yet, that didn't deter our friendship. We spent all our time together at school. Every time we'd go outside, we'd play together. Often we'd walk the distance to each other's house just to be with each other. In fact, we saw ourselves as brothers in such a way that we even cut our fingers and put them together and made ourselves blood brothers. You couldn't do that today with all the communicable diseases and especially COVID. But we did it then. Then the day finally came that he said, Would you like to go and spend the night at my house? So I asked my mother, I said, Mama, can I stay at the mayor's house tonight? She said, Sure. So he took me to his house, and his daddy met us at the door. There I stood with my bib overalls on and my bold haircut. Mama cut my hair. And his daddy shook his finger right in his son's face, and he got fighting mad. He said, I've told you, boy, these people are not our kind. And then he went on to say, you get this white trash out of my house and don't you ever bring him back in again. The boy, James, my friend, protested and said, but Daddy, he's my very best friend in the world and we're blood brothers. He said, I don't care what you are. They're not our kind and don't you ever have anything else to do with them. I went home and I told my mama in childish innocence. I asked her a question. I said, Mama, what is white trash? She said, who called you that? I said, the mayor. She put on her coat, jumped in our old 37 rattle trap pick'em up truck, headed down that dirt road with red dust flying directly to the mayor's house. Oh, how I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall when my mama saw the mayor up close and personal, as I'm sure she had some things to say. The only reason I tell you that story this morning is simply to remind you that some of us are not worthy to be in the presence of the royalty of God. Jesus Christ was not only a baby in the flesh of a man, but he was the royal King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And that means that people like an old cotton farmer's son couldn't approach Jesus because, as the mayor said, we just weren't that kind of people. But thank goodness that God withheld some things at first Christmas so that everyone, whosoever would come, would be able to come to the Lord Jesus. First thing I want you to notice, there was no palatial palace, but only a stinking stable. I want you to hear that in Luke chapter 2, verse 7. And so she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger. That's a feed trough, for those of you who might not know, where the animals fed, because there was no room for them in the inn. You know what that says to me? It says that my Savior was worthy to be born in the king's palace because he was the King of Kings. But yet, God chose that he would be born behind a hotel or an inn in a stable and then laid amongst the stinking animals in that manger where they fed. No fanfare, no great parade, nothing except a baby was laying in a stable instead of in a mansion. Now, I like that song that Elvis used to sing about, why can't every day be Christmas? If you're a Christian today, and you've invited Jesus Christ into your heart, every day should be Christmas. Because every time you get up, every breath you take, you are celebrating anew the fact that God saw fit to send the most royal gift that he had into a simple stable to be laid in a lowly manger so that regardless of who you were, where you came from, how much money you had or how little you had, you could still approach Jesus and ask him to come into your heart. That's a wonderful thing because most of us are not worthy to approach anyone that's royalty. I would have no idea that I could stand and look face to face to the president. Although when Gerald Ford was president, I did see him face to face as he presented me the Soldier of the Year trophy in 76. But you know how I felt that day? This little old country boy from lower Alabama, what am I doing in this White House with this president when I am not worthy to walk among such people? I remember a very wonderful blue-blooded lady whose name was Miss Helen Turner. When I was a little boy, she was my Sunday school teacher at First Baptist Church, Selma, Alabama. I'd ride the bus to church with my overall. Now listen, I was dressed up. My mama put a crease in them bib overall. And I had a white shirt on, and it was white. She bleached it 15 times. And it had creases on the arm. And she even put them down the middle like military wears. And I was fancy. But she'd meet me, this rich lady, at the bus every Sunday morning. She'd say, come on, son, I'm going to take you to Sunday school. Man, my chest would stick out. Here's this fine lady of society with this full-length mixed coat on and all these pearls hanging around her neck, diamonds dripping off of her fingers, and she's coming to take a little old farm boy, a cotton sharecropper, and take him to Sunday school. Then when Sunday school was over, she'd pick me up and meet me outside the door, and she'd say, come on now, we got to get down front before Dr. Lyon starts preaching. And she'd walk me, that aisle seemed like it was 100 miles long to me when I was a kid. She'd walk me right down that middle aisle of that big hoity-toity church, and she would sit me on the front pew, and she'd say to me, now you listen to Dr. Lyons, because one day you're going to be up there. I had no idea what she was talking about. Then she'd say, I mean it. You listen, because one day you're going to be up there. God told me that he's going to call you into the ministry. Listen, folks, I didn't even know what ministry meant. I had no intention of being a minister, and I was the least one of all mankind to be called. And I never thought about it. But you know what? I realized one thing about that lady. The reason she met me at the bus and got me from Sunday school, took me down front, and then took me back to the bus is because she knew she was protecting me from the remarks and the attitudes of those stuck-up, holier-than-thou First Baptist people. She led me by the hand. I pray today that in heaven, Miss Turner is able to look down and see that little boy that she cared for and brought me into that fine church among those rich people and treated me like I was as good as any of them. You see, that's why Jesus was born in a stable and laid in a manger. Because otherwise we'd had to be something special to come to Jesus. But because of his lowly birth, he opened the door to whosoever would come. Rich, poor, saint, sinner, it made no difference what your breeding or your bloodline was. We're all able to receive Jesus. Now, aren't you glad that he withheld that palatial birth and had his son come to us in a lowly stable and laid him in a manger? Secondly, I want you to understand that the announcement wasn't made to the blue bloods or the kings and his court, but the announcement of his birth was made by a group of angels from heaven. Luke 2:8 said, now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. I want you to get that. Those six words that all of us miss. Shepherds living out in the field. The announcement came to them first. And they were the lowliest low. You know what? They were Bedouin shepherds, which literally we would call gypsies. When Sarah and I have been to the Holy Land, I've been there four times. And she's been two, I think. And when we'd go to the Holy Land, you could ride down the roads and you'd see these tents made with skin, animal skins. Outside, there'd be a Cadillac or a Lincoln. And those Bedouin shepherds would stay on that field until their sheep eat up all of the grass that was available. Then they'd fold their tent and move to another field so they could feed their flock. They were the poorest of poor. And to the Jewish people, they weren't fit to be called human beings. They looked upon them as not a part of their society, but the the very dregs of society. They wouldn't touch them, speak to them, or even walk down the same street that they walked on. So there's a message there for you and me. God could easily announce the birth to the king. He could have said to all the royal people, I have brought forth my son, come and see. But he didn't. He sent angels from on high to go and find the lowliest people they could find. The shepherd that was an itinerant wanderer. And as they found them, they said, God sent us with a message for you. That must have surprised them, because you know, they were nobody. And for God to send his chosen servants, the angels, to come and tell them that Jesus was born, that was really something unusual. So what I want you to understand here is God was thinking of you and me when he sent Jesus that first Christmas. If he had sent him to a palace, most of us in this room would never have been saved. I know I don't have any royal blood. I know I'm not a son of a king, except King Jesus. But had it not been for the fact that these lowly shepherds were the ones that knew first, I would never have been able to accept Jesus as my king and my savior, my Lord. So aren't you glad that God thought all of this through? You know, sometimes we say, especially in the world today, I don't know what the world's coming to. I don't either, but I do know who's coming to the world. Amen. And God had thought it through, and he's thought it through what's taking place today. He knew that you and I needed a Savior. And we couldn't have that Savior if he didn't place him or announce to those lowliest of low that he had come into this world. So that all, whosoever, you know, I tell people all the time, you don't have to tell me your name. I know who you are. You're whosoever. That's who you are. Whosoever would call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And it's all because God withheld the announcement from the king and gave it to the shepherds. Now, finally, there was no gold-gilded birth announcement, but angels singing from on high. Luke chapter 2, verse 10. Then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. That's enough to make an old sourpuss Baptist shout glory. You know, I've been trying for over 50 years to get them to shout glory, and I ain't got nobody to do it yet. But I ain't gonna quit trying, I guarantee you. I want you to know, dear people, that the birth of Jesus was not announced in worldly fashion. Oh, God could have had someone go to the greatest printer around, get some silk paper, and use those words that were 14 karat gold on that silk paper, line it with diamonds and all other rich rubies and all types of gems. And he could have sent it to the greatest people on earth, but he didn't. He sent the angels from heaven to tell the lowly shepherds that you have a Savior now. And his name is Christ the Lord. Let me ask you something this morning. I want you to be very honest about it. Have you ever said to yourself, I'm not worthy of Jesus? Well, don't feel bad about it, because you're right. I'm not worthy of Jesus. But praise God, God thought we were, and still does. He sent the angels to sing the birth announcement of Christ, the lowly, lowly people, society's outcast, the wandering shepherds. And you see, that's three things that was withheld that made you and I able to become a child of the King. You know, I don't think I'll ever be remembered very much. And that don't bother me at all. Because you see, I didn't come here to glorify myself. My job is to glorify Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. I had a young man sent me an email the other night, and it blessed my heart. I was there when he was born. I was there as he grew up at the church. I was there to lead him to Christ. I baptized him, and I married him to his mate for life. And he said to me, Brother Ross, I'll never forget you as long as I live. See, if any of you have ever got a message from me, I always have my name down there and I say, forget me, but never forget Jesus. And he wanted me to know that I'll never forget you, nor will I ever forget Jesus. He said, you were the most important man in my life because you led me to know Christ Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Now, the background on that is the people of the church didn't want him there. He was like me when I was a little boy. He wasn't their kind. So I stood in the pulpit one day and I said, if he's not your kind, I'll resign because I'm not your kind either. If you don't love the lowliest of the low, and if you don't want the sorriest of the sorriest to come into the house of God so that they can meet Jesus Christ, then I'll remove myself and you can continue on to serve yourself because you're not serving God. I'm not a very humble person, am I? You want to make me mad, just turn away one of God's children. That makes me want to fight. Because you see, that's not my decision and it's not your decision. God said, whosoever would come. And he paved the way by withholding three things on that first Christmas night. And what he did was so you could find the lowliest bum on the street and bring him in and sit him in your church. And that's the one Jesus died for. When I was in Fairfield, Alabama, we had the whole complex was built by U.S. Steel. It was a steel town. And the Baptist church, four stories high, that I pastored, First Baptist Fairfield, was on that side of the square. The Methodist church crossed the courtyard, looked directly down our aisle, and we looked directly down their aisle when the doors was open. The Christian church was over here, and the Lutheran church was over here. And they faced each other. And then, a block away from the church, was tenement houses, row houses they called them. That's where the common people that worked for U.S. Steel lived. When I was there, U.S. Steel was mostly closed down, and there was just regular people. And I visited every one of them. And they started coming to church, and I hear this commotion one morning. You had to climb up about, I guess, maybe 40 flights of stairs to get up to the front of that church. It had big white columns, and it stood high, I mean, lifted up. And I went out there, and two of my deacons were saying to this person, listen, you're not going in the church. You are not properly dressed, and you stink. I said, what did you say? Well, they're not coming in, preacher. That's all there is to it. I said, y'all want to go to church this morning? Well, you visited us and invited us. I said, well, come on, take my hand. Let's go to church. I took them right down front and set them on the front seat. Oh, there was horrible gnashing of teeth. Those folks got so mad at me, they could have, I probably cut me up and shipped me somewhere. I don't know. But the deacon told me afterwards, said, "Preacher, you do that one more time, you're gone." I said, "Let me save you some problem. I'm going to do it another time. And so when I do, I'll just be gone. How about that?" Make a long story short, over 40 families came out of those tenement houses, and nearly 27 people got saved in that church. Every time one would get saved, they'd say, "We're going to have to empty the baptistry now and clean it out." I said, "Why?" "Well, you can't have them going in that water and somebody else going in behind them." I said, "God takes away sin, He can sure take away stink." Make a long story short, they finally learned. When I left there as their pastor, they accepted people, not position. Folks, what I want you to learn this morning is God came for everyone. The rich, the poor, the black, the white, the yellow, the brown, rich, the poor, or high bred, or blue blood, it doesn't make any difference. He came that whosoever who would come to Him should be saved. So I'm so glad this morning I've been able, this 11 days before His celebration of His birth, to tell you what was so special and what was missing that made that first Christmas so special for you and me. Now this morning I want to invite you to do something. If you never invited Jesus into your heart, this would be a wonderful day for you not to only hear this message but to respond to it. Because I don't care who you are or where you're from, Jesus died to save you. You didn't come here by accident today, but you're here by divine appointment. And God wants you to be saved. Now you can walk out those doors and say, "I'll do it the next time. Or I'm going to wait till we get a pastor." But let me warn you about that. This young man that I preached his funeral last week, last Wednesday, he was the last person on earth I thought they'd call me and say that he was dead. You see, it can happen to any of us. Don't die without Jesus. God's done everything He can to save you. Now it's all up to you. And if you are a Christian, wouldn't it be wonderful this Christmas not to just put up a tree and celebrate with lights and everything, but really worship Jesus? Say, "Lord, I'm so grateful that You withheld those things from that first Christmas so that I can belong to You and that You can live in my unworthy heart as my personal Lord and Savior." Maybe you just want to come to the altars and pray this morning. Maybe there's someone on your heart that you need to lead to Jesus. Every time I lead someone to Christ, it starts with prayer. I always pray for them before I try to witness to them. Because either Jesus is there working, or you can't do anything. I'm grateful that God has made it possible for all to be saved. Would you stand with me now for our hymn of invitation? Let's pray together. Father our God, I'm so grateful today that we have been blessed by having the privilege of being here in this place. And Lord, that we've learned that it doesn't matter who we are, just that we have an open heart, a receptive mind, and a spirit that says, "Lord Jesus, please come and live within me. Please be my Lord and Savior. And if we'll only do that, we shall be saved." Bless us now, Lord, as we respond in accordance with Thy will. In Jesus' name, amen.